If you gathered a small random group of people and tested them for diabetes, what percent would actually be diabetic? Well, we did something like that while we were in Nigeria, but they weren't really a random group. They were all related to Benedicta, so you're going to meet some of my in-laws in this video, including my mother-in-law. We invited them to the hotel banquet room and had a traditional Nigerian meal with them. But we decided to make this more than a meal. We decided it would be good to test their blood sugar before the meal and 1 hour after the meal and see what kind of blood sugar spikes they had. Out of my 7 in-laws, my mother-in-law and her sister opted out of the test. They didn't want their fingers stuck with any needles. But of the 5 that did agree, how did they come out? Well, you'll find that out in the following video. Well, we are back from Nigeria, and I want to say a special thank you to those of you who prayed for us and those who donated to our ministry and helped us cover the budget for our Nigerian mission. As has often been the case, when we started planning for that mission, we didn't have a lot of money in the bank, and we had to trust God to move on hearts to help us minister in the great continent of Africa one more time. And actually, this was the very first time I made an appeal to our YouTube community, and you guys really stepped up and helped make it happen. So thank you, thank you, thank you for your generosity, your compassion, and your heart for the gospel of Jesus Christ and the people of Africa. And we had some wonderful meetings there. I'll be sharing a video report, but it'll take a little while to get that put together, so just be patient and wait, and we'll get a video report out to you as soon as we can. Well, greetings to our YouTube community. Say hi to all the YouTubers.
Hi, YouTube.
So we are coming to you from the land of
Nigeria.
Nigeria. And we have had some great meetings, haven't we?
Yes, we have.
We have been greatly blessed to be here to preach Christ and to teach God's word. But we're here to talk about diet, the diet of the Nigerians. You know, I kind of think we could consider Nigeria the land of soup. What do you think?
Yeah, we surely have a lot of soup, and we've been eating it since we came.
Yeah, we've been eating soup practically every day, Nigerian soups, and I have to confess, I've been a bad boy.
Yeah, I know.
You know, when I am home, I'm skipping breakfasts at least half the time. I'm doing some fasting. I'm trying to finish my meals before 7, and now all of that has been gone, thrown to the wind.
Yeah, I think we try to adjust and readjust. Because of the meeting, we get back to the hotel late, so we had to eat late. It's not your fault.
Yeah, well, I don't like to preach on an empty stomach. Some pastors act like the more spiritual you are, the more you'll fast and then preach. But I preach better when I'm full. How about you?
Yeah, I try to eat a little bit here and there.
Yeah, a little bit. Well, we're talking about soup. Nigeria, they love soup. What are some of the soups we have enjoyed throughout these last week?
We've eaten oha soup. We've eaten edik aikon. We've eaten okazi soup. We have eaten egusi soup. We've eaten ogbono soup. So a lot of soup we've eaten. You know, some I can't remember now, but we've eaten a whole lot of soup and fufu.
Yeah, and I was telling Benedicta, the soup part of the meal is very healthy.
Yes.
I mean, we've been eating vegetable soup, which to me is about like spinach.
Right, right.
Similar to spinach. And then they throw in some fish.
Yeah, a lot of fish, stockfish, and the other types of fish. You know, here is where we live in Nigeria, where we have a lot of river, a lot of the beach and everywhere. So we have a lot of fish, and, you know, we've been eating some of these fish, including stockfish.
Stockfish is the big Nigerian fish. And so when you're talking about fish and you're talking about green leafy vegetables,
yes,
that's healthy stuff.
Very healthy. Our soup is healthy. It's yeah, not the kind of soup that you use flour to thicken and or thicken it. So it's like the vegetable, some oil, fish, and everything makes it, you know, wonderful. And we love it. And it's like healthy. So it's really blood sugar friendly, because the more vegetable we eat, the more healthier. But if you eat a lot of the dough, it may be a problem for somebody who has a blood sugar problem, but if you don't have blood sugar problem, it's okay.
Well, American soup, you know, some people think soup is bad for diabetics. It a lot of times is, because American soup oftentimes is thickened with flour. They use noodles, they throw in rice, sometimes potatoes, a lot of stuff that's going to jack up that blood sugar. But Nigerian soup has almost none of that.
So, some of our soup, we're taking them with some seed that we grind, and they are also healthy. They are not harmful to your blood sugar. So some of these we put together, and our soup is made.
Yeah. So yesterday we had a grand experiment. Yes. We had some of my in-laws, my mother-in-law, and a sister-in-law, a niece-in-law, you could call that.
In-law.
We had a marvelous meal together, and we had the soup, and we had the fufu made of, what was that called?
Samovita.
Samovita, which is a grain product, a flour-type product. The soup was healthy. The fufu, the samovita, was not. And boy, they serve big old helpings of that fufu, don't they?
Yeah, you know, we have this soup and we know how to eat them. So we use them to feed our children, and the men like it. Our men loves it, our women loves it. So when you bring that dough up in here on the table and the soup by the side, man, it's party time. And then we go, you know, kind of downloading the whole thing. And then everybody will be like, damn, we are so full. So we did that yesterday with the family, and it was awesome.
And tell me, if you went to somebody's house who was going to serve you a meal, and they served you a big bowl of soup, but there was no fufu, none of that doughy stuff, what would you think?
Incomplete food, incomplete.
That would be incomplete. So we served them both. We let them eat pretty much what they wanted out of it, but they almost all ate everything, didn't they?
They ate everything, and it wasn't meat. It was stockfish in there. Everybody got a piece of a chunk of the stockfish, and then the soup. So it was really great, and the dough, mostly the other person, except one person and then him, that didn't finish their dough. I think I did mine, a little bit remained, but, you know, they really enjoyed it, and they finished their dough and their soup.
So we did a test of 7 people. Now, your mama did not want her fingers punched,
yeah,
so we didn't do mama. And her
scared.
Sister was with us, and she didn't want that either.
Yeah.
So we had us plus 5 others. So we knew what our blood sugar pretty much is. We test ourselves a lot. But those other 5, they didn't have any idea of how they stood metabolically in terms of blood sugar.
I enjoy getting together with Benedicta's family, and I know she really appreciates it. Many African women who marry Americans never get back to Africa again and very rarely get to see their relatives. So when we minister in Africa, it's a double treat for Ben. She enjoys the ministry, and she also enjoys the time she gets to spend with her mother, her sisters, and other relatives. We weren't sure how many would be willing to do the blood sugar test, but most were good sports about it. Around the table, we had a man we'll call Mr. X. He's actually a policeman, but he didn't think it good to have his face to show on a video that would be public, so we have to blur out his face. Seated next to him was Ben's mom, Elizabeth, then Chijoki, her brother-in-law, and then Cornelius, her niece's husband, then her niece, Uchechi. Next was Happiness, Ben's sister, and then Ben's Aunt Rose, and then, of course, my lovely wife, Benedicta. I served as the medical tester and went around one by one before the meal to test everyone's pre-meal glucose levels. The policeman amazed me with a glucose level of 70, a very low number. This man is in his 40s, but he works out 3 hours a day and stays slim, so I guess this really helps. The others were more normal, with the exception of 2 that concerned me. Ben's sister Happiness had a 134, which is too high, especially since she said she hadn't eaten since breakfast. And Ben's niece Uchechi's glucose was at 136. Since the diabetic level by American standards is 126 and above, this was not good news. Ben's pre-meal score was a solid 82, and mine was 97. Afterwards, we ate our meal of soup and fufu. The soup was a typical spicy Nigerian soup with cooked greens and fish, so I knew it would have very little effect on our blood sugar. The fufu, well, that was a different story. After we ate, we all sat around and visited. The hour passed swiftly, and then I went around the table one more time, testing each one's blood sugar. Mr. X rose from 70 to 108. Chijoki went from 85 to 129, and Cornelius actually dropped a few points from 102 to 99. Ben's glucose rose to 120, which was good considering how much fufu she ate, and mine rose to 119. Of course, I ate far less fufu than anyone else, which is why I could keep my glucose at a decent range. But what about those two who started out in the 130s? For Ben's sister, Happiness, there was good news. She actually dropped low after her meal, down from 134 to 114. That was a relief. But for Uchechi, the news wasn't so good. Her blood glucose soared to a high of 264 one hour after eating, which certainly suggested diabetes. Until then, she had no idea that she might be diabetic, and as far as we knew, had never tested her blood sugar before. I told her that diabetes was a possibility and she needed to see her doctor, to which she agreed. Well, let me sum up this experience with a couple of thoughts. Sadly, I would say that in America, in Africa, in India, and probably in most places in the world, if you were to gather together a small group of adults who've never been tested for blood sugar, there are pretty good chances that one or two of them would be diabetic. Diabetes is not just an American problem, it is a worldwide epidemic. And because diabetes is so very, very destructive to our bodies and our health, we need to find out just where we stand in this area. When it comes to soaring glucose levels, ignorance is definitely not bliss, nor is it smart. Every adult should get tested regularly. A second point I want to make is that even though my post-meal blood glucose was in the normal range at 119, pretty close to all the other non-diabetics in the room, I could easily have been just as high or higher than Uchechi. In fact, had I not been watching my diet and eating low carb all these years, and had I eaten the same amount of fufu as she did, I would probably have scored in the 300s or more. But instead, I scored a mild 119 as a blood sugar peak. And the reason is that for the last nearly 20 years, I've not eaten the way most Americans eat. And when I saw that huge mound of doughy fufu, what I really saw was raging high blood sugar. And now I did something none of the others did. I ate my meal with a spoon rather than with my fingers, the way every good African does. The way you eat this meal as an African is to make a ball of the fufu and then make an indentation in the ball of dough and then use that as a spoon to eat your soup. So for every bite of soup you eat, you're going to be eating a good-sized piece of fufu. But I knew that would spell disaster for me. I couldn't possibly eat that way. It wasn't that I was too American to eat with my fingers. I just knew I could not eat a ball of doughy fufu with every bite of soup that I took. So I did the smart thing. I asked for a spoon and I would eat several spoonfuls of soup for every bite of fufu. And when I did eat the fufu, I took small amounts of it in my spoon. So I was getting far more soup than I was fufu, whereas everybody else, well, they were eating more fufu than soup. And as a result, when I tested my blood sugar an hour after eating, I had a very respectable 119, virtually identical with Benedicta's score, even though in an equal test, she would beat me all over the place. But this is what we who have a tendency toward diabetes do. We go light on the high-carb foods and we go heavy on the low-carb foods. And it works for us. The same thing would be true if you were invited to a friend's house who served you a dinner of spaghetti and salad. You wouldn't necessarily have to forego the spaghetti entirely. Just have a small amount of spaghetti and a huge whopping salad. Your friend won't be insulted that way, and your blood sugar would stay in bounds. So whether you're African or American, Australian or from the Middle East, the point is that people with metabolic issues absolutely cannot afford the luxury of eating a lot of carbohydrate in their meals. Now, here's a secret for you. The truth is, no person should be eating high carbs. Even if your blood glucose seems to be under control, your insulin levels are almost surely soaring way too high with all those carbs, and that will eventually take a toll on your body. Sometimes it leads to diabetes, sometimes to cardiovascular problems, sometimes hypertension, and nearly always it will eventually lead to obesity. It is not smart to go through life pushing your metabolic system to its absolute limits and hoping you'll get by with it.
We just wanted to say hi from Nigeria. We've had a marvelous time, and I posted a bunch of videos before I left so you wouldn't miss any. But when we get back, we'll get with you with some new stuff.
Yeah, we'll get them posted, right?
And get her involved in some more tests, because you keep telling us with you want Benedicta, more Benedicta, please.
More Benedicta, please. More Benedicta, please.
So, again, Dennis and Benedicta saying greetings, and God bless you from Nigeria.